to the Ohio State University Summer Commencement, held Sunday, August 9th, 2015 at the Jerome Schottenstein Center. 981 graduates received their diplomas. The commencement speaker is Bruce A. McPheron, Vice President for Agricultural Administration and the Dean of the College of Food, Agricultural, and Environmental Sciences.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 410th commencement of The Ohio State University. I am President Michael Drake, and we are pleased to have you as honored guests as this university bestows academic degrees upon today's graduates. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I have the distinct honor of introducing our commencement speaker. For more than three decades, Dr. Bruce A. McPheron has been a distinguished agricultural educator and innovative genetic researcher. Serving as Ohio State's Vice President for Agricultural Administration and Dean of the College of Food, Agricultural, and Environmental Sciences since 2012. Dr. McPheron has been praised for his ability to connect the farmer in the field as well as the scientist in the laboratory. An Ohio native, Dean McPheron earned his degree from Ohio State University in 1976 in entomology, the study of insects. He followed this by graduate and doctorate degrees from the University of Illinois in biology and entomology. Dean McPheron began his career as an extension agent in Claremont County before heading to Penn State University, where he rose through the ranks over a 24-year career, ultimately serving as Dean of the College of Agricultural Sciences. Dr. McPheron has conducted research throughout Latin America, Africa, and Australia, and tools he's developed have been used to monitor the spread of invasive fruit fly species by the United States Department of Agriculture. Graduates, families, and friends, please welcome Dr. Bruce McPheron.
President Drake, trustees, colleagues, family and friends, but most importantly, graduates. It's an honor to join you here today for your commencement from The Ohio State University. When I sat on your side of the podium nearly 40 years ago, we were just over in St. John Arena across the river, I felt a sense of accomplishment and I felt a bit of trepidation at what might lie ahead. I can guarantee you one thing that was not on my mind that day was the possibility that I would be on this side of the podium. I do remember that commencement 39 years ago. It was at the end of winter quarter. I even remember my commencement speaker, Alex Haley, the author of Roots. I have no idea what he said, but I remember him. There is one other memorable part of that graduation day. Some of you may have heard of an Ohio State alumnus named Archie Griffin. He remains the nation's only two-time Heisman Trophy winner, and he was also in that March 1976 graduation ceremony. Since my return to Ohio State 3 years ago, I've had many opportunities to interact with Archie, and I finally asked him if he remembered me from graduation. Regrettably, he said no. I'm glad you were seated for that revelation. I mean, it really disappoints me. I was just 75 rows back and to the left. By the way, graduates, since I brought up the subject of Archie Griffin, I'm afraid a few of your families are likely to point out that had you not dropped those couple of classes, they might have been able to hear Archie as your commencement speaker in Ohio Stadium last May. Sorry, you're going to have to explain how they got a bug doctor in the shot and not a two-time Heisman Trophy winner in the shoe. Good luck at dinner tonight. In any case, I hope that you find some memorable component to today's celebration of your success. When I was announced as the commencement speaker, a number of my colleagues began to inquire about whether I was going to bring bugs or to tell bug stories. As I reflected on that question and how to answer, I did a little research, and it turns out I'm apparently the third entomologist to address an OSU graduating class. The first was Raymond Osborne in 1924, who served as the chair of the Department of Zoology and Entomology. His address is in the university archives, and it's 24 typewritten pages. For the graduates, a typewriter is what we called Microsoft Word and a laser printer back then. And I believe from the scholarly analysis in that presentation that there was likely an essay exam administered at the end before the graduates were permitted to receive their diplomas. The second entomologist was Professor David Denlinger, who spoke to the graduates in 2008 right here in this facility, all the while with a giant walking stick sitting calmly on his academic regalia. Well, I'm not going to repeat that. In fact, I believe the shot now has an insect screening process for all academics entering the facility. Here's my story. I'm a Buckeye and I'm a bug guy. At the age of 11, the Ohio State University handed me a career. I was a member of Ohio 4-H in Union County, just one county up the road to the northwest of Columbus. I happened upon an insect collection at the county fair after a couple of years of caring for rabbits, and I decided I'd try a new project. When spring came, I was hooked. I caught my first butterfly using a saucepan from my mom's kitchen. We made all the equipment, and a neighbor helped me build a display case to take my collection to the county fair. As the years passed, my collections grew, and my projects began to resemble experiments in addition to the collections. I cannot for the life of me remember why I had a colony of speckled cockroaches in a surplus medical incubator in our basement, but I can tell you that it's a time in my life that my mother recalls quite vividly. I knew early on that in order to be a professional entomologist, you needed specialized college training, and I never considered any alternative other than the Ohio State University. Those cockroaches came from a professor here in Columbus. My ultraviolet light trap that I used to catch and count armyworm moths one summer came from one of our entomologists on our Worcester campus. And he actually listed my trap reports in the newsletter he sent out to extension agents. This was one proud high school student to have his results reported by the Ohio Agricultural Research and Development Center. And so I came to Ohio State to become an entomologist. That decision opened up a world to me, and it brings me to be with you today. In fact, we're all here today because of the common thread of the mission of a great university. The Ohio State University is a land-grant institution, and permit me to refresh your memory about our complex mission. First, we have an obligation to teach students. The Morrill Act of 1862 that created the land-grant university really was largely focused on access to education for the children of the middle class. This was a sea change in how our country thought about the role of higher education in society, and this one piece of legislation has had a transformational impact on the United States and the world. At 145 years and counting, Ohio State is still accomplishing this teaching and learning mission. A second piece of our mission is to generate new ideas. We call this research and creative accomplishments. And Ohio State has become an incredibly productive engine of innovation. Whether we think of extraordinary new works of art or foods that can help prevent cancer, whether it's an analysis of a key event in history or a new battery technology to store solar energy, Ohio State is a powerhouse. But we live in a world demanding instant accountability, and some have asked whether research is compatible with that mission of educating students. They've asked if research and creative works are a good investment in a cost-conscious world. It's a more complex question than we can fully explore here today, but I'll provide one simple statement for you to ponder. I would note that while every college and university in the world uses books, only a handful of them write the books. The Ohio State University is one of those few whose faculty routinely write the books. Students graduating today have learned in classrooms with mentors who are dreaming the future through their scholarship. You graduates are better prepared for your future because you've learned from those faculty. There's one more key component of Ohio State's mission, and it derives from the first two. This third component is engagement. Let me provide a bit of a history lesson and then suggest the critical importance that engagement has and will play in our graduates' lives. That land-grant mission to educate the sons and eventually the daughters of the middle class was a change from the norm of higher education for children from economically privileged families. The mission framed by Senator Justin Morrill and signed by President Abraham Lincoln further stipulated that in addition to a healthy background in the liberal arts, these new land-grant colleges were to provide training in practical subjects. This initial focus on practical subjects for our students at the university led us to think about how this same practical knowledge would be useful to citizens and businesses in their communities. Our land-grant universities became engaged universities. Our mission grew from the classroom to the laboratory and library to the community. The land-grant university portfolio of engagement began with our roots in agriculture and mechanical arts. Cooperative Extension, today called OSU Extension here in Ohio, offered farmers' schools and institutes to bring the principles of science to one of the key industries of the day, agriculture. Our agents, now called educators, took the lessons from the university into communities across the state, realizing that a key way to disseminate new ideas was to engage young people. A.B. Graham of Clark County near Springfield, Ohio, established a Boys and Girls Agricultural Club to improve corn yields on their family farms. This movement by Graham was the foundation of 4-H, one of the world's most impactful youth development programs. It is, in fact, 4-H that weaves back into my own story and my early interest in bugs. I became a scientist because science was very alive for me. 4-H forced me to learn by doing, the 4-H slogan. Well, 4-H, Extension, and Outreach more broadly demonstrate the power of engagement. The university is engaged in communities across the state, solving problems and improving the quality of life in Ohio and beyond. And the citizens of the state are engaged with the university, and even more importantly, they're engaged in their own lifelong learning processes. Graduates, whether you realize it or not, you've been very engaged with your university. You successfully navigated your classes to arrive here in this ceremony, but you earned more from Ohio State than a transcript. Let me demonstrate. It's time for your last quiz before you get your degrees. Audience participation here, all right, you with me? Right hand up. How many of you have had at least one international experience during your Ohio State years? Okay. Left hand. How many of you conducted research? Better see every hand up over here. How many of you participated in service learning or a service activity? Both hands. All right. If you completed an internship or a co-op experience, give me a hearty OH. If you participated in one of our 1,000 clubs or organizations, respond with an IO. It's as I expected. You were engaged far beyond your class schedule in the Ohio State experience. Now, at this transition in your life, know that a piece of that experience will accompany you as you face the future. I submit that your success from this point on depends upon your willingness to take engagement to the next level. Let me be specific. 1, engage in your career. Some of you will walk into the job of your dreams. Embrace that and engage fully. Others will have a more circuitous route. For me, even though I had a career mapped out as I entered my teenage years, the path wasn't linear. There were unexpected twists and turns, just as you'll likely experience. but engage in your career and embrace the learning opportunities that emerge. Second, engage in your personal development. Studies clearly demonstrate the importance of developing oneself as a contributor to all other measures of success. Your friends, your family, your health all add up to success, not just in the personal realm, but in your professional life. And these relationships don't work on autopilot, so engage actively for a full life. Third, engage in your community. Many in this audience saw firsthand, as an Ohio State student, the power that each of us can have in changing our communities and the world. Through service learning experiences and with friends from clubs and organizations, we rolled up our sleeves and immersed ourselves in making a difference. And you're not just an extra set of hands. Those hands are connected to a well-trained Ohio State mind, a mind that learned the importance of understanding the situation, gathering relevant facts, bringing in new ideas, and solving problems. Finally, I would challenge you to engage in your university. Stay connected. You may be gone, but you're not forgotten by your alma mater when you leave this campus. And that should be mutual. Ohio State is on a trajectory to be an international leader in tackling significant issues for society. We want you to be part of that. I could name 100 different initiatives that we're addressing, but I'll mention only one, one that's near and dear to my heart. 1 in 7 Ohio jobs is related to agriculture. From producing to transporting, processing, and serving our food, we are an extraordinarily rich agricultural state, a rich food state. Yet last year, about 1 in 6 Ohio families experienced food insecurity, which we define as an inability to ensure nutritious meals for members of the household. The situation is even more dire for Ohio children. In fact, Lisa Hamler-Fugit of the Ohio Association of Food Banks provided a very graphic vision for any Buckeye. The number of food insecure Ohio children would fill the Ohio Stadium 6 times and leave a line outside. This in one of the richest food states in the nation. So I was delighted when in President Drake's investiture speech this past March, he announced a Buckeye assault on food insecurity as part of his 2020 vision. This rallying cry will rouse your successors, graduates, and it should stir your emotions too. We need all hands on deck if we're to create a food secure society. This disparity should not and will not stand. With such powerful initiatives as this to motivate you, engage with your alma mater on an issue that touches you. Join your local alumni society and organize them to make a difference where you live. Connect with our Office of Volunteer Relations and ask to help on a project. Offer to recruit students, visit classes, or mentor aspiring job seekers for your college or department. You truly have to intentionally disengage to avoid engaging. There are just so many ways to help. Graduates, today truly is an important day, a day celebrating great accomplishments, your accomplishments. But you're not finished. When you accept your diploma, you become a part of the history of this great institution. My charge to you is to commit to being part of its future. Thank you and best wishes.
And to the graduates, first of all, let me say congratulations. What a day to celebrate. Graduations are among the most special and impactful days of our lives. I remember among my earliest memories going to the graduation ceremony for my brother from high school. He was 11 years older than I, so I was, he graduated a bit soon, so I was 5 or 6 years old, and I can remember that day all these years later. I remember that it was hot and that the speeches were too long, but that everyone seemed very, very proud. And actually, he was ahead of me in school, and so I went to several graduation ceremonies from him, and among the favorite pictures of my family is a picture I have that I happened to take of the audience, and it showed my parents and my younger brother and his wife then at the time, and the great pride and joy that they had reflected on their faces is something that I remember, again, all these years later. And it's very wonderful for those of us who participate in this process to look out and see the families here today and to see that same pride and sense of accomplishment and sense of love reflected in their faces. So these are great days. And when we look at our graduating class, we see some of the best and brightest who are ready to inspire from children in the classroom to new discoveries in laboratories, people who are ready to go out and lead their communities and our communities forward. We're very, very proud of you and very excited to know that the future is in your excellent hands. I'm confident that you will extend Ohio State's reach around the state, across the country, and around the world. Those of us who travel anywhere know that there are Buckeyes everywhere, and Buckeyes everywhere are making a real difference in the lives of the people around them and the lives of all of us. You will fulfill our university's mission by using your education to transform lives and make the world a better place. And that is why we are here to celebrate today. It's appropriate at graduations. One is always asked to give advice to graduating classes, and there are three simple bits of advice I like to share with graduates. And I'll think about this, Bruce. I'll run into you years later and see if you remember any of these. That'd be a great thing. I remember them well. I get a chance to repeat them, and I hope that there are things that can be helpful to you. The first is something to do now, and actually, if you'll focus back a bit, in January, we had a great football season last year. A little roughness at the very beginning, but then a good middle and end, and then a great real end in. Yes. Go Bucks. But we had a great season, and I had a conference to attend in India, and I delayed the time I was leaving to go to the conference so that I could make sure to be in Dallas for the game at the end of the season. So that was great. It then meant, though, that I had about 30 hours of airplane travel over the next 4 days to go there and to come back. And I had a chance to read a book during the cabin. And I read a book that was focused broadly, without a particular endorsement of the book, focused broadly on mindfulness and sort of being present in our lives and being able to focus on what we're doing with the understanding that our lives are the only lives we have and that this moment is the only moment we have, and that if we let it go by without being present for it, it's just gone. And I think we all are rushing from place to place and time to time and thing to thing all day, every day. And it just is a good thing from time to time to take a pause, to take a breath, to realize where you are, what you're doing, and the special blessings that that so many of us are able to appreciate. This time is one of those times. The great effort and achievement that are represented here today, the great level of support that you've received from friends and family and loved ones that brought you to this moment, the hours and weeks and months and years of work and focus that you've put into being able to earn a degree from a distinguished university like this is something that's worth taking a moment to step back and pause and breathe in and say, this is a good thing and it's a good day. So I am very excited to be here with you. My three pieces of advice. The first is to think about the people who you love and respect and admire the most. Actually, think about them. Actually, many of them are here with us today. It's a great chance for that. And if you think about those things that you admire and respect the most, often it's something that derives from that person living a values-driven life. They all know what's important to them, and they know why. And I encourage you to follow in those footsteps. As you're making decisions, refer to your inner compass and then do what you know is right. Use your own values to help guide you. Good decisions lead to good places. Good decisions lead to good moments in life, like this moment here today. And so do your best to live a values-driven life, and I think that you'll continue to have good moments like this as you move on. The second piece of advice that I would give is to, as much as you can, in all things, do your best. Your life will work for you if you're striving to be your best self, whether it's writing a paper or preparing an interview or showing up for your first day of work or raising children or being a family member. It's an important thing to do. My active practice was as a medical doctor. I'm an ophthalmologist. And I learned from my father-in-law once a great adage, and that was that he always said to himself when he was finished examining a patient and leaving the room, he would pretend that as he was leaving the room, the chief of service was coming in the door of the same hospital room, and that she was going to go and examine the same patient. And then he would ask himself, if she goes and examines the patient, will she find something that I missed? If it's something that I missed because I didn't know, then there's something more that I can learn. But will she find something that I missed because I didn't do my best exam? And if you were ever not able to say, no, she couldn't find anything that I missed because I didn't do my best exam, if you weren't able to answer that question appropriately, he'd go back and do the exam again to make sure. And I remember that throughout my medical career, and I will say 1,000 times, more than 1,000 times, I took another look or another listen at something to make sure that I was 100% sure that I'd done my best. It actually only took a few seconds each time to do that, to make sure to know that I'd done my very best. But over the years, it helped me maintain a standard of practice that meant that I had many more good times than bad times. And so I always think that it's a good thing to guide our inner compass with values and then to make sure we're doing our best and putting forward an effort that we would be proud of if someone else were to look over our shoulder. And finally, I want to make sure you remember that you are enabled to create your future. Dr. McPheron, when he spoke today, spoke of having a very clear path from the time he was a bug collector to the time he became a professor. And that is true for many people. But for many more people, that is not so clear and it's not so true. Our pathways change from time to time as we go forward. And what we realize is that our futures aren't really preordained or set out for us most of the time. Most of the time, our futures can be created and influenced. And the person who is the most the greatest degree of influence on our careers would be ourselves. As you imagine your future, remember how important you are to your future and how empowered you are in making that future come to fruition. It's an important thing for you to be able to make a difference in the world and to make the kind of difference you'd like to make. Know that you can do it. Our goal here at The Ohio State University is to enable and to empower and to inspire you to make a difference. And we hope very much that we hope and believe that we have given you the tools to do that. We want you to have the confidence to change our world and to make it better. And finally, at most graduations, I like to share a few words from one of my favorite poets. This is Rabindranath Tagore. Tagore was born in India and won the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1913, the first non-European to win that prize. His many writings, the one I'll share with you today is just a few lines of inspiration. And he says, reach high, for stars lie hidden in you. Dream deep, for every dream precedes the goal. Congratulations, class of 2015. Reach for the stars.